Orthodox Church of America. When I have some more time, I will look into the options for blogs. One thing I have not liked about blogs is they seem difficult to organize and customize. But not knowing anything about web design and not wanting to pay for a website, that might be the only way to go. Regarding Bishop Gregory's article, you will notice that he misapplies the 1983 anathema against ecumenism in the same way that the old calendarists do, by latching onto the word ecumenism and anathema, and basically ignoring the content of the statement and what specifically is said to be anathema. Bishop Gregory expresses his view that all local Orthodox churches, because of involvement in the ecumenical movement, are by extension heretical and without grace. The Roll Court Synod never believed or pronounced such a thing. Bishop Gregory was right, however, to point out the dubious origins of the Synod in resistance to fault Roll Court for not addressing this subject and to fault Roll Court for entering into communion with them. He is also right that the Synod in resistance incorrectly uses the 15th canon of the First Second Council to justify their schism, since the adoption of the new calendar is not a heresy that has been condemned by a past council or father. On the other hand, the Synod in resistance is correct in quoting St. Nicodemus' explanation that a bishop who begins to preach heresy still serves grace-filled mysteries as long as he is recognized as a bishop by the rest of the church, and that such a bishop's sacraments only become devoid of grace if that bishop is deposed by a council. Bishop Gregory scoffs at St. Nicodemus' explanation by saying that Roman Catholics justify themselves by saying that they were never specifically called to a council and then anathematized or deposed. Bishop Gregory here makes the same mistake as Vladimir Moss, overlooking the first canon of St. Basil, which says that those who go into schism lose the grace of the Holy Spirit in their mysteries. As a side note, it would be interesting to study more fully the radicalization of Bishop Gregory Grab, Metropolitan Filaret, and Roll Court during the 1960s. Metropolitan Anthony Krapovitsky and Metropolitan Anastasi both were adamantly opposed to interfering with the Greek Old Calendarists, for instance. Bishop Gregory was appointed Chancellor of the Roll Court Synod in 1931 by Metropolitan Anthony himself, while Bishop Gregory was still a priest, and Father George / Bishop Gregory remained very involved with the Synod until he left Roll Court near the end of his life. Why then did his views depart so much from those of Metropolitans Anthony and Anastasi after their repose? Holy Transfiguration Monastery was received into Roll Court in the 1960s. They were very close to Bishop Gregory, and they worked very hard to get Roll Court to adopt the same views as the Greek Old Calendarists that they admired. HTM primarily was drawn to the Matthewites and spoke very disparagingly about Archbishop Auxenios. It seems that the Matthewites have played the most prominent role in radicalizing everybody. I believe they radicalized the Greeks at HTM, who then played a big role in radicalizing Bishop Gregory, who then had a big influence on radicalizing Metropolitan Filaret. Bishop Gregory and HTM never succeeded in radicalizing Roll Court entirely, which is why no communion could be sustained between them and the various old calendarists. Archbishop Auxenios and the late Archbishop Chrysostomos of the GOC were both formerly Matthewites and contributed towards radicalizing what was left behind by Metropolitan Chrysostom of Florina. Vladimir Moss, another former Matthewite, played a prominent role in radicalizing ROAC, ROAC, and other groups that he joined. It would be interesting to better study the how and when of Metropolitan Filaret and Bishop Gregory's radicalization, but the connections are there, as is the stark contrast between Roll Court in the late 1960s on, after the repose of St. John the Wonderworker, and Roll Court of the 1920s to 1950s. Concerning the OCA / Metropolia, yes, it is true that the Metropolia was under Roll Court and went into schism unlawfully. I believe that this is the source of all the problems in the OCA today. It is true that Roll Court and the OCA are today on good terms and accept each other as part of the one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, but it is also true that the OCA status as autocephalous is still not accepted by roll call, the ecumenical patriarchate, the Patriarch of Antioch, etc. St. Ticon's ukase allowing the formation of a higher church authority was written in 1920. At that time, such a higher church authority authorized by the ukase was beginning to form under Metropolitan Anthony of Kiev, who was nominated by the All-Russian Council of 1917 to be the first candidate for Patriarch of all Russia. The lot then fell on Metropolitan Ticon of Moscow. When communication became impossible with Moscow, this higher church authority began to form initially within Russia until persecution and the general turmoil in Russia forced the Synod abroad. Metropolitan Evlogi of Western Europe and Metropolitan Platon of America, it is important to clarify, were appointed by the higher church authority under Metropolitan Antony as the bishops of their respective dioceses. So, Metropolitan Platon of America was appointed by roll call in 1922 at the recommendation of Patriarch Ticon. Roll call decreed as follows regarding the appointment of Metropolitan Platon. May it stand in view of the expressed desire of His Holiness, Patriarch Ticon of Moscow and all Russia, that Metropolitan Platon of Kherson and Odessa accept the administration of the North American diocese communicated by V. Rev. T. Pashkovsky, who had arrived from Moscow in the report of July 1/14/1922, number 1, and in view of the consent of Archbishop Alexander to the temporary transfer of the administration of the diocese to Metropolitan Platon. Metropolitan Platon is considered temporary administrator of the North American diocese. In 1924, Metropolitan Platon participated in the roll call council at Sremsky Karlovsky, was elected to be a member of the roll call synod, and he expressed his full submission to this council. However, in 1926, there was a council of the American diocese in Detroit which attempted to assert the autocephaly of the Russian churches in America under Metropolitan Platon. In 1926, when Metropolitan Platon returned to the roll call council in Sremsky Karlovsky and reported on this Detroit council, roll call responded by stating that the Russian diocese in America had no canonical right to assert its own autocephaly, and neither would the Synod acknowledge such an assertion. Metropolitan Platon then left the council along with Metropolitan Evlogi, and it was then that both bishops separated from roll call and went into schism. The American diocese, Metropolia, later came back into communion with roll call in 1935 of their own accord, affirming all the more that they recognized the authority of roll call. Sadly, however, in 1946, the Metropolia again went into schism from roll call without any canonical justification. Of course, the Metropolia was later recognized by the Moscow Patriarchate and given autocephaly in 1970, at which time they became known as the Orthodox Church in America. But this autocephalous status is disputed by other local Orthodox churches. The matter will be resolved in time, however. That being said, there are some very good priests and parishes in the OCA. For some good information on the history of roll call and the relationship between the Metropolia and roll call, see this link. Again, grace resides in the church, and all those clergy and bishops who remain in the church administer grace-filled mysteries. The OCA/Metropolia did wrongly go into schism from roll call, but I do not think that they were out of communion with the rest of the church. This was a confusing time, and those in America who were under the church in Russia were uncertain how to proceed and how to interpret Patriarch Ticon's ukase regarding how to administer matters without the Patriarch and Holy Synod. A schism indeed took place, and I believe the Metropolia was at fault. Yet this was an administrative matter rather than a dogmatic one. Today, there is no doubt regarding the mysteries of the OCA because the rest of the church recognizes the OCA as part of the church and having grace-filled mysteries. This is not disputed, but only their autocephaly. Similarly, roll call is not deposed because the rest of the church recognizes roll call as part of the one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. The Moscow Patriarchate's involvement in the WCC and the International Orthodox Catholic Dialogues in recent years has brought Orthodox involvement in both ecumenical venues to a near standstill. Nevertheless, we live in an age of relativism, indifference, lack of faith, and religious pluralism, and many among both the laity and the clergy have sadly been infected with the spirit of the times. Many laity, and sadly some clergy also, do not read the fathers, and out of ignorance they do and say things that are simply false. The problem plaguing the Orthodox churches in our times may be more a problem of secularism than of ecumenism, as the laity and clergy who fail to understand the boundaries of the church are typically just as ignorant of Orthodox involvement in the ecumenical movement and of various joint statements as they are ignorant of the writings of the saints and fathers. With regard to the Moscow patriarchate priest communing a Roman Catholic priest, the question should be asked whether the priest did this following the direction of his bishop, whether he did so out of ignorance, whether out of defiance, etc. Again, if you read the Moscow Patriarchate's document concerning the non-Orthodox, the Holy Synod is very clear in stating that the Orthodox Church is the one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, and that communion is the fruit of unity rather than the way to unity. The primary player with the Moscow Patriarchate in ecumenical dialogues is Metropolitan Hilarion of Volokolamsk, the head of the Department for External Church Relations. He has spoken and been interviewed many times on the subject of unity between the Orthodox and the Roman Catholics. He repeatedly states that unity is possible, but only on the basis of the common faith shared in the first millennium prior to the Great Schism. He has said the same thing in talks given to the Anglicans. Metropolitan Hilarion has also stated very clearly that there is no grace in the sacraments of schismatics, for instance. The Church does not recognize and cannot recognize as grace-giving and salvific any sacraments, including baptism, administered in a schism. This is a common point of view confirmed by many testimonies of the Church tradition. Recognition of schismatics, sacraments, is an altogether improper expression which can be only misleading. The point here is not a diplomatic manifestation of politeness, but attempts to impose on the Orthodox the recognition of a real presence of saving grace outside the Church. For the Church, the authenticity of sacraments is a matter of salvation. It is impossible and senseless to speak of recognition of sacraments administered by schismatics who stay outside the Church and have no communion with her. So based on the statements of the Holy Synod of the Russian Orthodox Church concerning the non-Orthodox, as well as the statements given by Metropolitan Hilarion of Volokolamsk, who represents the Moscow Patriarchate and all dialogues with the non-Orthodox, I believe that the priest you mentioned was acting in disobedience to his bishop. The following article from Elder Epiphanios Theodoropoulos on the Old Calendarist is worthy of a careful read. He wrote an excellent book entitled The Two Extremes, Ecumenism and Zealotism, that is the source of these words. Hopefully, in time, this book will be translated into English. It is worth noting that I.M. Andreev left the question open-ended and that his writings on the subject were in 1947. At that time, this was an open question in Rokor, yet they refused to make a determination on the matter, waiting with hope for the fall of communism so that the subject could be investigated more fully. Unlike Mr. Andreev, we have the benefit of living through the fall of communism and seeing the fruits that have been born since this time, though of course there is still a long way to go. There are now many wonderful works that can be read which undoubtedly, unless the heart is already as hard as stone and deprived of the grace of God, answers the question of whether today's Moscow Patriarchate has the grace of God. The book Everyday Saints by Archimandrite Tikhon Shevkunov is one such text. There are also those saints in Russia who were perfected while under the authority of the Moscow Patriarchate, including many of the new martyrs. Elder Sebastian of Optina's life is worth reading in this regard, as he was a clairvoyant and discerning elder in the full spiritual heritage of the Optina Monastery, yet he remained formally under the Moscow Patriarchate. The life of Saint Seraphim of Vyritsa is another. There are many such examples of men whose lives were filled with grace who remained under the Moscow Patriarchate during the Soviet era, and yet who did not compromise themselves with the Soviets. Roach and Antioch. Valentin of Suzdal was deposed by the MP for sexual immorality, then received into Rokor. Rokor was not aware of his sins, deposed by roll court and then convicted of pedophilia while Metropolitan of Roak. Concerning Roak, Father Michael Protopopov makes a few comments in his article on the RTOC. The first to approach Emeritus Metropolitan Vitali was Valentin Rusantsev of the Suzdal Group, which first called itself the Free Russian Orthodox Church, FROC, and later changed its name to Russian Orthodox Autonomous Church, ROAC. However, Metropolitan Vitali rejected all overtures from this quarter as he firmly believed the Suzdal Group to be totally uncanonical and Rusantsev to be deposed. However, in Mansonville, Bishop Varnava Prokopiev, having been suspended in his episcopacy in 2001 for a number of canonical violations, came from France and manipulated the confused Metropolitan to renounce his retirement and declare himself to be primate of the Russian Orthodox Church in exile, ROCIE. In fact, Bishop Varnava became de facto head of this new and uncanonical organization and used the name and reputation of Metropolitan Vitali to further his own ends. Two other bishops also decided to join the new ROCIE organization in Mansonville, Archbishop Lazarus Serbenko and Bishop Benjamin Rusalenko, who had at one time gone to the Suzdal group and returned to the roll court, now left again without a canonical release. This meant that the Synod of Roll Court placed both bishops under ecclesiastical ban for breaking their oaths of loyalty to their synod. Archbishop Mark of Berlin was asked in an interview about Roak. Question. In Russia, besides the Moscow Patriarchate, there is also another alternative church, the Russian Orthodox Autonomous Church, headed by Metropolitan Valentin Rusantsev, with its center in Suzdal. What is the attitude of the Russian Church abroad to this hierarch? Archbishop Mark, the answer to that question is quite unambiguous. He was defrocked for serious misdeeds and therefore cannot be either a bishop or a priest. For us, he is nothing more than a monk. Bishop Evtiki of Ishim in Siberia made some remarks about his own struggle leading up to the reunification with Moscow and his much regretted decision during this time to receive communion from the same chalice as Valentin. The greatest feeling of sin which unforgettably scalded my sinful soul was receiving communion of one chalice with a schismatic Valentin in Suzdal in the winter after the Council of Bishops in Lesna in 1994. I had committed many sins, but there was nothing worse in my life than the way this sin wounded me. I implore all those who are in schism or thinking of going into schism, do not do what you will. Do not doom yourselves. Force yourselves instead, even through sorrow, to submit to the will of God. Heed now the words of Christ, who prayed before his suffering on the cross. Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. John 17:11. Osetrov told parishioners in Suzdal that he had a video film showing interviews of adolescents admitting to intimate relations with the Metropolitan. This film turned out to be less incriminating than Osetrov claimed and would in any case have been inadmissible as evidence in a court of law. More serious was the accusation of the well-respected hieromonk Paisius Gorbunov that he personally had witnessed a homosexual act of Metropolitan Valentin in 1995. Enormous pressure was brought to bear on Father Paisius, who repented of his accusation, then reaffirmed it and fled into hiding with the help of his spiritual father, Archbishop Seraphim. The Metropolitan now demanded the defrocking of those clerics, about five, who accused him of immorality, and eventually obtained the signatures of the other bishops, although Archbishop Seraphim delayed signing for 6 weeks. Between June and August, the Vladimir newspaper Priziv printed a series of 8 articles in support of Osetrov's accusations. Fighting to stay out of prison, the Metropolitan claimed that Priziv had received direct orders from the Vladimir Public Prosecutor's Office and Regional Administration to publish compromising material on Valentin. In an interview with Keston College's Geraldine Fagan on March 26, 2002, Ossetrov maintained that since Metropolitan Valentin had actively restored churches, whereas the Moscow Patriarchate had been quite incompetent in that area, he had enjoined some kind of protection from the Suzdal authorities. Father Ossetrov admitted that he himself had been instrumental in maintaining the state of affairs throughout the 10 years during which he had worked as synodal secretary to Metropolitan Valentin, initially having been ordained in Roka. When any accusations against the Metropolitan of homosexual practice, a criminal offense in Russia until 1993, or sexual abuse were made, he said he arranged everything so that they died away or got lost in bureaucratic channels. Once he had been removed after protesting that Roak clergy who preached heresies were not being dealt with, said Father Ossetrov, his protection of Metropolitan Valentin had ceased. This time I gathered evidence and sent it to reliable people in the Lubyanka, the headquarters of the FSB, and the Vladimir Public Prosecutor's Office. Had the affair been left to the Suzdal Public Prosecutor, he maintained, it would have been completely covered up. When Kestan asked how Father Ossetrov had managed to serve in the Roak for 10 years without suspecting Metropolitan Valentin, he replied that the accusation of homosexuality, Golubizna, was commonly used as an easy way of discrediting a person in the Soviet period. While the rumors about Metropolitan Valentin grew from year to year, he said, they were at first vague and he was disinclined to believe them until some of his own children began to relate details they had heard at school. Father Ossetrov said that he then discovered that the Suzdal authorities' protection of Metropolitan Valentin dated back to 1988. I was shocked. Both the local police and administration knew everything. In that year, said Father Ossetrov, local police investigated the then criminal activities of 70 homosexuals in Vladimir region, including then Archimandrite Valentin. An article in the May-September issue of Suzdal Diocesan News, partially edited by Father Ossetrov, contains computer scans from the original police files on criminal case number 0543, including various witness statements graphically describing homosexual activity involving Archimandrite Valentin. According to Father Ossetrov, this was why the Moscow Patriarchate attempted to transfer Archimandrite Valentin from the town of Suzdal, in response to which he ultimately left the Moscow Patriarchate. In his view, the only possible reason why Archimandrite Valentin was not prosecuted by the authorities at that time was because he was working for the KGB, who, he said, most probably used his sexual orientation to compromise him. When interviewed by Kestan on 19 October, Roak Archbishop Fyodor continued to maintain that the allegations against Metropolitan Valentin were being fueled by an alliance of the Vladimir authorities and the Moscow Patriarchate. The parish priest of Suzdal's Kazan Church, Father Dmitry Letko, and Archbishop Yevlogi Smirnov of Vladimir and Suzdal were the local Moscow Patriarchate representatives present at the June 2001 meeting aiming to sort out Valentin, thought the Archbishop. While declining to confirm whether such a meeting had indeed taken place, Father Leonid did tell Kestan that there were anonymous persons in authority who wished to see Metropolitan Valentin removed. Without them, there would be no court case or publications or anything. In August 2003, the Metropolitan was convicted of pedophilia by the court and given a conditional 4-year prison sentence. The sentence was upheld by the appeal court in the autumn, but in March 2004 his conviction was expunged. Although there had been no new evidence and no new trial, Vertograd immediately trumpeted this as an acquittal. However, one of the lawyers of the Metropolitan himself contradicted Vertograd, saying that this legal whitewash was based on the Metropolitan's private acknowledgement of his guilt and would be removed immediately if he misbehaved again. The virtue or immorality of a bishop does not affect the sacraments that he serves. What matters is not whether the bishops of Roac are holy or immoral, but whether they are truly bishops in the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. They are not in communion with the Church, so they are not a viable option for a person who is seeking salvation in the ark of salvation. Apparently, there was some kind of agreement between the last Patriarch of Antioch and the Monophysites, but this agreement was met with major outcry from Orthodox bishops, clergy, monastics, and laity. A single bishop, patriarch, or local church does not have the authority to undo or revoke the dogmatic decrees of the ecumenical councils. Now, it is sadly true that there are many academic theologians and professional ecumenists that think the issue of monophysitism is just one big misunderstanding and that we really believe the same thing. This has sadly led to some clergy wrongly giving communion to monophysites, likely out of ignorance rather than defiance or the acceptance of heresy. In any case, the Orthodox Church is not in communion with the monophysites, regardless of what a piece of paper signed by a previous patriarch of one of the churches may have indicated. Furthermore, if communion is wrongly given to heretics, the clergy and bishops who do this will have to give an account before God if they are not corrected by their own synods. The giving of communion wrongly to heretics, however, does not contaminate the rest of the church. If this were the case, the body of Christ would have been contaminated from the beginning. If you look at the history of the church, you will find instances of inner communion with Roman Catholics in certain parts of the world for many centuries after 1054 and even after the Council of Florence. You will also find instances when Orthodox patriarchs, bishops, and clergy gave communion to Anglicans. You mentioned that you have heard that the Patriarch of Alexandria is in communion with Monophysites. If this is the case, the Patriarch would not have assisted Minas Manur in his conversion to Orthodoxy from Monophysitism. If Monophysitism is now considered Orthodox, we would not see Monophysite clergy received into the Church of Greece by baptism. Additionally, if the Church of Alexandria or Antioch went into communion with the Monophysites, when did this occur and which TOC or GOC group was started when bishops broke communion with Alexandria or Antioch over this decision? Retroactive self-justification is not the way of the canons, the fathers, the saints, etc. Claiming that one was correct in breaking communion in 1925, 1935, 1965, etc., based on something that is claimed to have occurred decades later in the 1990s, is nonsensical. Regardless of what some may think and what academic theologians and professional ecumenists may claim, the so-called Oriental Orthodox are not part of the church but are in heresy. Saint Euphemia confirmed this by a miracle at the Council of Chalcedon. More recently, Elder Paisio spent a great deal of time in prayer over this subject, concerned by what he was hearing by some who are in the church, and had this to say in disbelief regarding the claims of certain academic theologians and professional ecumenists. They do not say that the Monophysites did not understand the Holy Fathers, but that the Holy Fathers did not understand them, namely, as if they are right and were misunderstood. So many Holy Fathers who had divine illumination and were their contemporaries did not understand them but misunderstood them. And here we come so many centuries later to correct the Holy Fathers? Why don't they even consider the miracle of Saint Euphemia? Is it possible that even she had misunderstood the Book of the Heretics? Orthodoxy is not in communion with the Monophysites, and the various TOC/GOC schisms were not started for reasons of ecumenism or heresy. Old Calendarists should repent. From Father Alexander Lebedev of Rocourt in 2000. A few comments are a bit dated. For instance, Father Anthony Gavalas, who at the time was under no bishop, has since joined the Matthewites and has become a bishop with the Matthewites. Also, Gregory of Colorado joined a few more synods before ending up all by himself and in communion with nobody. Father Alexander makes a number of important points. The recent and unjustified departure of Father Stephen Allen from the Russian Orthodox Church outside of Russia has caused me to wish to address a fundamental issue that seems never to be mentioned. That is the place of canonical order in the Holy Orthodox Church. If one reads the posts of many, such as Basil or Vladimir Moss, who post on this list, one would come to the conclusion that all that is necessary to be a true Orthodox Christian is to find a bishop who espouses true orthodoxy and to join him. You are justified in leaving your own bishop according to this teaching if you feel that he is not sufficiently orthodox according to your own judgment. Canonical order is of no matter, and this is what concerns me. Those who promote the above-mentioned approach constantly talk about how, in order to be orthodox, one must follow the teaching of the Holy Fathers and to strictly hold to the holy canons. They frequently cite the canons forbidding prayer with heretics, or the 15th canon of the twice-held council, which in very limited circumstances allows one to separate oneself from an openly heretical bishop. However, these people should be aware that the overwhelming majority of the holy canons have little to do with dogma or theology, but concern good ecclesiastical order. Those who violate good canonical ecclesiastical order are subject to the same penalties as those who pray with heretics. This seems to be forgotten by our orthozealots, who seem to feel that it is not at all a problem to jump from synod to synod or jurisdiction to jurisdiction as one sees fit. The proliferation of true Orthodox synods is absolute canonical disorder. It violates the entire concept of ecclesiastical law, which demands that the laity, the priesthood, and the episcopate be accountable to higher ecclesiastical authorities who have the right to impose canonical penalties up to and including deposition from holy orders and excommunication from the church. Let's address the Greek Old Calendarist question directly. If, after the introduction of the new calendar, certain bishops who disapproved felt strongly enough that this was a heresy condemned by a council to depart from the state church of Greece and form their own synod, that could have been in some way justified from a canonical perspective as long as it were to be understood to be a temporary situation pending the return of the heretical bishops to orthodoxy. But if any members of this old calendar synod were to break off and form another synod, there would be absolutely no justification for this according to the canons. The bishops who split with their hierarchy would be nothing more than a parasynagogue, and their deposition by the original synod would be absolutely canonically valid. In Greece, we have seen a never-ending stream of splits in the various old calendar synods, resulting in mutual excommunications and canonical chaos. Is this what being a true Orthodox Christian means? We must remember that the Orthodox Church is not just an abstract collection of dogma, a theological system of beliefs. It is a God-established institution here on earth with a very specific set of laws governing its activities, laws that are codified in the Book of Holy Canons. And therefore, it is not good enough to say Bishop X's synod holds the true Orthodox faith. It does not concelebrate with ecumenists and believes the new calendars are without grace. You have to find out not only whether Bishop X's synod holds the faith, but whether Bishop X's synod is canonically valid and not a parasynagogue, i.e. not the result of a break between bishops that was not canonically justified. Let's be frank here. There is no question that the splits and resplits among the various old calendar Greek synods have little to do with issues of the faith. All old calendar synods adhere to basically the same ecclesiology. No, the splits were primarily due to issues of power, control, and yes, money. Are these valid reasons for splitting from one synod and setting up your own? Absolutely not, according to the canons. The canons require that every bishop must know who his primate is and to which synod he is canonically subject. If he departs from his synod and creates his own, he is to be deposed. But the situation of the old calendarists in Greece is that no bishop or priest is truly answerable to any synod at all, because he, if he wishes to, can either jump to any one of 20 other old calendar synods, or if he is able to persuade a couple of other bishops to go with him, he can start yet another synod of his own. Even more serious is the case of a bishop or priest who, for his actions, is subject to discipline from his synod. He can avoid prosecution by simply jumping to any other jurisdiction. And this has absolutely nothing to do with how strictly he keeps to the teachings of the Holy Orthodox faith. This canonical disorder is what allows a group such as the followers of the Guru, Elder Panteleimon, when their ecclesiastical authority was taking canonical actions to investigate serious moral charges against their fake accented leader and others, to choose from a veritable smorgasbord of Old Calendar Greek bishops. They chose Metropolitan Gabriel and Archbishop Akakios, and thus escaped from ecclesiastical investigation and trial, although flight from prosecution is generally considered an admission of guilt. Then, before a year had passed, they spurned their own ruling bishop, Archbishop Akakios, not for any valid canonical reason or reason of faith, and joined the Synod of Archbishop Auxentios, whom they had maligned in the worst way previously. The Synod of Auxentios consecrated bishops for them, and these new bishops became members of the Auxentian Synod. Suddenly, through an amazing feat of prestidigitation, the other bishops of the Auxentian Synod magically disappear, and presto, changio, the HTM group bishops suddenly become the entirety of the Auxentian Synod themselves, even though they don't even have a single bishop in Greece. The canons consistently speak about the boundaries of the jurisdiction of an individual local church or an individual bishop. In the current situation of ecclesiastical disorder, all of these boundaries are somehow erased in a priest or an individual in East Elbow, Colorado, can place himself under some Greek metropolitan 10,000 miles away who doesn't even speak his language. There can be no accountability in this type of situation. Eventually, you get to the absurdity where you believe that there are no true Orthodox bishops remaining in the world, as does my dear relative Father Anthony Gavalis, who serves without commemorating any bishop or synod at all. To whom is he accountable? If he committed a serious canonical infraction, which synod or bishop would judge him? People say that all this is the result of our being in the end times, and that with the arrival of the Antichrist so near, one should expect that the number of those keeping with the true faith would be very small. Setting aside the impudence of deciding for God when his second coming will be, these excuses have been used for centuries to justify canonical disorder. See what happened in Russia with the old believers. As soon as their connection to the Church of Russia was cut, they began to fragment into a myriad of sects. Sadly, we see this happening among the old calendarists in Greece. Nothing better proves that they are on the wrong path than the proliferation of splits among them. If they were united in one mind, they would be a formidable alternative to ecumenism and modernism, but they are disintegrating into mutually condemning tiny groups, continually splintering into smaller and smaller pieces, although one must admit that they have increased the chances of monastic clergy becoming bishops tenfold, much to the joy of the Panagia makers of Athens. There are now 10 times more old calendarist bishops in Greece than bishops in the state church, although there are 100 times fewer parishes. Unfortunately, these often very young bishops share another characteristic in addition to swift careerism. They are almost to the man totally lacking in theological education, there being no theological institutions of learning among the old calendarists. No, my friends, true Orthodox bishops are not enough. You also need true Orthodox canonical order. Otherwise, you will continue to see things like former Abbot Gregory jumping from the Russian Church abroad to the GOC Synod of Archbishop Chrysostomos II, and then jumping to the newly created Synod of Metropolitan Callinicos of the Twelve Islands. And the priest formerly of the Russian Church abroad, Father Stephen Allen, according to my sources, who jumped ship to the Matthewites under Archbishop Andrew, has now reconsidered and is also reported to have jumped again to go under the omophorion of metropolitan clinicals. 3 jurisdictions in 3 weeks. Now, that's true orthodoxy in action. Just ask Vladimir Most how many jurisdictions he's been under. This is what puts the Russian Orthodox Church outside of Russia in its unique and estimable place. It strictly holds to true orthodoxy as shown by the recent epistle of Metropolitan Vitali. It also maintains true orthodox canonical order. It was chartered by a directive of a canonical first hierarch of the historical Church of Russia, Patriarch Tikhon, and it has never split from anyone. Its canonical basis is firm, and its ecclesiastical discipline is based on the holy canons. The choice for a traditional Orthodox Christian is clear. Stick to a church that has been staunchly traditionalist and in good canonical order since its creation 80 years ago, or pick from the merry-go-round of old calendar synods that have been splitting, realigning, splitting again for just as many years, to the point where there are now over 20 Greek old calendarist synods, with many more to come, no doubt. True orthodoxy? Make it true idiocy instead. With love in Christ, Proto-Priest Alexander Lebedev.